Good morning. Welcome to Crossroads, One Church Crossroads. We're so happy that you joined us this morning. In Psalms, we were sharing in the back. In Psalms, I think it's 122. It's how good it is to come into the house of the Lord. Are you excited to be at church this morning?
Yes.
Let's get excited. If you're not, it is good to be in the house of God. Why don't you stand up with us? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we just ask that your presence would be here. Change lives. In your name we pray. Amen.
I love that. Get excited if you're not. Hug a neck and have a seat.
Mm-hmm.
Good morning. Welcome to One Church Crossroads. We are part of the One Church Network, and we're so glad you're here with us this morning. And my name's Tracy, and I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and I'm going to ask my wife to join me. This is Shelly. She's the beautiful side of the trio, or the duo, not a trio. God and us. God and us. Yes. That's. I don't know what you were thinking. But I was thinking, you know, it's always
good
God
recovery.
And us. Yeah, so pastor's got to make a good recovery. So, yeah, whoo, I'm going to just hand it over to her now. Thank you for being here. Have a good day. I'm glad I'm not preaching today.
Here at Crossroads.
We are not into trios. Lord, help me.
Yes. If this is your first time here at Crossroads, we're so glad that you are still here. And that you came back today. Okay.
Real people, real issues, real hope.
That's what we say here at the Crossroads campus. Whew. Okay. Anyway, if this is your first or your second time here, we're happy that you are here. And I have a communication card in the planner. If you would fill that out for us, we'd be so thankful to just send you a thank you gift. And then we take a little break here in a little bit, and we have a gift for you. Okay? Is that it?
I think so. I think
I'm
so. I have
on.
No idea. Just move right along.
I have some reminders for you. Okay, Summer
just
Camp for Kids is coming up, and it's called Camp Whatever, which seems to be a theme this morning. Okay, it's called Camp Whatever for our elementary school kids.
Oh, whatever.
Okay, and it's July 13th through 16th. We have registration forms and information back in Children's Church. You can talk to Tiffany Versola or to Danielle Lopez back there in Children's Church for registration information for Camp Whatever. The cost is about $200 per kid, and this is what we did our big You Are Egged fundraiser for, was to help kids get to camp. So that's coming up, and deposits are due by the end of this month if you'd like to send one of the kids in your family.
All right. We have a men's breakfast and a sports shoot. So that's coming up on June 6th, and it's going to be in Turlock at Hot Rods. Is that it? All right. And if you want more information, last year we went up to Comanche Lake, right? And we did the shotguns up there. It was a blast. My arm was very sore for a few days, but it's a great time. It's a great time to be with guys, get to shoot some guns. That's always a fun thing. You know, you never can miss out there. But if you want more information, would you see James? He's in the back. He works with our ushers, greeters in the green shirt. So wave your hands, James, like you just don't care. There it is. That's James back there. I'm just trying to dig myself out of a hole, James. Come on, help me out. All right. There it is. So see him if you're interested in that. It's about $35, and then you got to cover your own breakfast. So, but it's going to be a great time. Also, next Saturday, we have a major work day going on here at the campus, and I need your help. So here's what I'm going to ask you to do. On this card, would you fill it out right now? Take it out right now. I'm watching you. The camera's rolling. Fill it out. Say you will be here. We're going to start at 9 o'clock. We're going to have lunch for you. But we really want to, big things, we want to get the back area behind our kids' ministry. We want to get that tore up, leveled out, so we can have a place for our kids to go out. That's not quite as dangerous as it is right now. We don't let them go out there right now because it's pretty sketchy back there. We've lost 3 people back there already. And we just can't do it anymore. But one was a whole family, so it was terrible.
Got swallowed up in that swimming pool, huh?
But if you can help us out, it's going to be a great day. It's always fun when you get together and you get out here and you work and you scrape your knuckles on stuff and get to have some fun with some of the guys. So be out here, be a part of that with us.
And that's one of the great things about being part of Crossroads right now is we are in week 12.
Yeah,
12, 13. Yeah. This is our 12th or 13th, 12th, I think, Sunday here. And it's amazing. We are like, I was walking somebody around the campus the other day, and I said, we are at the ground floor. But the truth is, we're kind of just only at the ground. We're not even at the ground floor
yet. Well, if you're back by the pool, we're below the ground.
So if you're looking for a church family, we would love to be that and have you partner with us and grow this campus for the Lord.
Tonight we have our Grow Dinner. We have, I think, almost 70 people signed up to be here. So it's going to be a great night. We're excited about it. We've been working on this for a couple months now. And it's just, if you have not signed up, we can still probably squeeze you in. You need to see Sheila at the connection break. Sheila, can you stand up? Sheila, can you stand? No, I'm just kidding. That's Sheila right there. You need to see her, and she'll get you connected with that. It's going to be a great time. We are going to have a time of worship along with that tonight, and just really seeking God and how we grow in our relationships with Him and with others. So please be a part of that. And I think that's everything, I think.
At Crossroads, we believe that God is awesome and church is fun.
Yes, yes. It may not be fun, but I sure am funny.
Yeah, it's funny. Okay.
Funny. Well, we're going to have our ushers come at this time. I want to say thank you once again for your faithfulness in giving and supporting the ministry that happens through this campus and through this church. And so excited to see what God is doing and hearing reports of His faithfulness in lives and people's lives. And just want to encourage you that God is faithful. God is, He is all we need. And so just if you're faithful with Him, He'll be faithful to you. So Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for the blessings that you provide for us. Thank you that your word promises us that if we are faithful to you, that you are faithful to us. And so, Lord, I just pray that you bless those who give today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And as they're giving, I just want to, we're going to head into worship here in just a minute. You guys can go, ushers. And as they're making their way to the back, I read this scripture this morning. And it just encouraged me. It says, yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. You see, God is spirit, and His worshipers must worship Him in spirit and in truth. So our heart, our desire is that the Spirit works in our lives, that He's here in our presence, and that we are true worshipers. They're not here to entertain. We're not here to entertain. We're here to worship God. And so if you're new and you're a guest and you're not familiar with that, you just kind of just relax and take it in and contemplate what's going on. But I want to encourage you, if you are a follower of Christ, worship Him in spirit and in truth. Let's stand to our feet. Lord, I thank you for today. We humbly come before you in worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is no life without you. You have all that we need. Where you are, every fear is no life. There is no life without you. You have all that we need. Where you are, every fear is broken. And the must we closer and closer.
change, Lord. We reach out, Lord Jesus. We reach out, Lord Jesus. Beyond our circumstances, Father, we choose to reach out this morning. Closer and closer to you, Lord God. We come running this morning, Lord Jesus. Beyond our circumstances, we come running, Father. When we meet you there, Lord Jesus, you meet the need. You change us, Lord God. You change our perspective, Father. We come running this morning.
Stronger, God, you are higher than anything.
the way you're singing, our God is real. Yes.
Awesome.
He's the healer. Somebody needs to know he's the healer.
Able to come into the presence of God and experience His marvelous and His wonderful love. You know, there's just times that I just need to know need to be in that place where I feel the Father wrap his arms around me and say, I love you. In spite of you, Tracy, I love you. In spite of your mistakes, in spite of your attitudes, in spite of your stupidity, I love you. And that's that time when we can come in as true worshipers and go to that place. Is just, it's an amazing thing that this God, the creator of the universe, who knew no sin, who knows no sin, loves us. Loves us. That is amazing grace. Lord, we thank you today for that incredible grace that you gave us through your son's sacrifice upon the cross for each and every one of us. And we just want to worship you. We just want to say thank you for loving us. While we were yet sinners, you sent your son to die for us, Father. No greater love has one man than to lay his life down for another. And that's what you did for each one of us. So Lord, today we celebrate that. We worship you. We give you glory. We praise you. We give you honor. Lord, because of your gift to us of grace, we just give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated for just a moment. Well, we are so glad you're here. In just a minute, we are going to continue our series that we began last week on Mother's Day called Guardrails. And if you missed last week's, I would encourage you to go and watch last week's message. I'm pretty critical of myself, but I did a really good job last week. Oh, no. Ta-da! All right. I was with my older boys yesterday and their buddies, and normally I won't push on them to go, like, watch Dad's message, but I felt like the starting of last week's series of Guardrails was a crucial series for all of us. In my life, and I was with them at a graduation party, and as they're holding their Coors Light, Blue Mountains, I was like, you guys need to go listen to my message, go to Visit One Church, and all their buddies are looking at me like, I'm telling you, it's the greatest message I've ever preached, and I said, it had nothing to do with me, it had all to do with God, but it is one of the most, for me, was one of the most impacting and powerful messages that I've spoke in over 20 years of ministry. And so if you have not seen it, go watch it. You'll hear a little bit about it today. We are talking about guardrails. How many have seen, you were here last week, you've been looking at some guardrails this week as you were driving, right? You're checking out some guardrails going, huh, never noticed those were there, all right? That's what guardrails are for. We don't notice them typically until we hit them, until we need them. And so guardrails are a system designed to keep us from going into danger zones. And so we're talking about spiritual guardrails in our lives. And guardrails spiritually in that sense is a set of behaviors. It's establishing a set of behaviors that become a matter of conscience when you run into them or you get close to them. So that's what we're talking about this week. We have a special guest. We flew them in all the way from Modesto. So they're here with us today. And I'm so excited to hear my parents speak to us. But just before we do that, we have some donuts. We have some coffee. We got some water. And if you are a first-time guest or second-time guest, we got some gifts for you. You'll go out these side doors right here. We got it all set up for you there. And everybody else, you're out back. Not the pool out back, but back in the back of the room there. And we're going to be back here in about 10 minutes for the message. So stand to your feet, meet somebody you don't know, go grab some donuts, coffee, and we'll be back in just a minute. Well, we are in week two of Guardrails, avoiding regrets in your life. How many would say you got at least one regret in your life, right? All right, some of you are really stretching up there. You got quite a few. We're going to pray a little later. This is a great series, and I'm so looking forward to this morning to hear from mentors, because they've been in my life for 47 years. They've been blessed. But they have just been pillars of what it means to walk with guardrails in your life and to walk in a life with few regrets or no regrets. And so I'm so grateful for them. They're going to bring the word. Would you just do me the honor of welcoming my parents, Pastor Cliff and Pastor Carol? This is for you. Oh. All right.
We do that a lot.
Well, in case you hadn't noticed, the title that we've given our sermon today, which hasn't come up yet, but you could put it up, is the Mr. and Mrs. 54 and Counting. So, there's been a lot of those smooches to keep this thing going for 54 years. You know, that's a good fuel for marriage. Did you know that? Yeah. Kissing stuff and that hugging stuff and that being sweet stuff, that kind of helps a marriage.
I was reminiscing when we started. How many like to hear what happened on our honeymoon? No. I'm of an age and a generation we don't talk about those. Actually, we got married before there was Visa and MasterCards. So the only credit card was a gasoline card. So if you went on a honeymoon, you paid cash. And we had saved, and we had $100. Now, to be fair, motels were about $15 a night, but you had to pay for your food and everything with $100. And how many are old enough, or at least you read in history about something that's called that's called the Asian flu? How many remember? It was so nasty; people were dying because of it. And it was an epidemic, and when we got married, I come down with the Asian flu, and almost died, and on our honeymoon, I was so sick I couldn't hardly lift my head up, and so Carol, she knew I had to help. Well, and back then it was before insurance. So you didn't go to the hospital unless you were dying. And I was too sick to go to the hospital because I was dying right where it's at. And well, I tell you how sick it is I was thinking dying on my honeymoon was a good option. And so
I really think things get bigger the farther away you get from them. You want me to tell this story so we can get on with the message?
I'm done.
I'm going to give the punchline then. So I had taken some penicillin along with me because I knew that he was very, very ill. And I gave him the penicillin. And unlucky for me, he picked up the bottle that I had the penicillin pills in. And it happened to be my dog had had distemper. And they were the dog's penicillin distemper pills. But they worked. And he's still alive. So, but he said he has barked and chased cars ever since.
And that's the truth, folks.
Oh, dear.
Amen. I want to, how many have been married less than 10 years? And how many are planning to get married? I just met a couple that are planning to get married. I know there's something that you never anticipate, but I want to show you what happens because you're going to get older. And the older you get, the different. Let's play that video. So it just kind of show you what's going to happen in your future.
I'm Christy.
I'm Tavis.
And we know each other because we're getting married.
In a month. I mean, not really nervous about the idea of marriage. I'm just ready for that already.
Yeah, not anymore. Now we're a month out already. Just ready to...
More about just like
everything. Get the show on the road.
We're going to be able to show people this. Like our
kids. Or like, you know, our family. Like this is what we'll look like. My mom thinks this is the coolest thing ever. And she was like, but what a treat for us that we... Because we will probably be gone when you're that age. And we'll get to see what you would maybe look like. How cool. Neat way to think about it.
Are you ready for this?
Yeah!
Let's do it. Hi.
Hi.
I hope you look like this.
Oh, good.
You're fantastic. What?
Yeah, I'm gonna look just like my mother one day.
Oh my god. Okay, so I need to start using sunscreen. That's definitely it.
What are some stereotypes of this age?
We're gonna have a pretty stereotypical life, but we already have a rescue pit bull and we drive a Subaru.
We'll probably have a couple of teenagers. That'll be rough.
That'll be terrible. We'll be on the PTA. Oh god, that sounds so weird.
Take a look.
Oh. How are you doing?
You've been in the sun.
Your eyebrows.
I'm pretty happy with the way that she looks, yeah.
You look a lot older than I thought you would. I look like my grandma.
Oh my god. I did not age well.
I hope I'm taking better care of your hair at this age.
Why are you getting so emotional?
I don't know.
I can't help but think about what the potential last 50 years were.
Yeah.
Like, to see her look like this makes me just think of where we have gone to be next to each other at looking like this. What would have happened in between?
Well, I have kids and grandkids and so many stories.
Yeah. And we'll be forgetting things. So many things.
We'll have to take care of each other.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just a really kind of affecting thing to see someone that you've known since you were, I don't know, 19 look in their 70s and imagine what life would be like.
Now, I don't want to discourage you because it can be different because I think my wife is prettier now than the day I married her. And I mean that sincerely.
That helps a marriage, too. when you get these chins and the muffin tops and all this stuff and he still thinks you're beautiful, you get up in the morning and your hair looks like you've been through a tornado and he says, oh, you get up so sweet. Oh, gotta love a guy like that. But today we want to talk to you about the marriage. And I know that there are some here who are not married. You maybe don't plan on being married. There's some of you who have gone through some divorce situations and we are definitely a church that understands that singleness is a gift that God gives to some. Marriage is a choice that you make, a covenant that you make, and God has a lot to say about it. And this morning, I want you to understand, I think sometimes we treat marriage as though it's our own decision, it's our own choices, and we don't put the spiritual emphasis on marriage that we should. And to me, marriage is one of the highest callings that you can take, one of the greatest areas where you can glorify God, one of the greatest weapons against the enemy when you keep it solid, one of the greatest testimonies that you can have is a healthy marriage. Therefore, because it is that important, guardrails are so important.
That's how I get to say something. I raise my hand. See, our technicians are, we're so blessed. Thank you, Daniel and Tommy. And just try to catch up with us wherever we are. Just throw anything up on the screen. It doesn't matter. But I would say this about singleness. And it's not revelation, but you usually marry who you date. And so that's why the Bible is very explicit when it says a believer should not marry an unbeliever.
And that's why your parents, for some of you that are younger and you've been hounded by your parents, don't be unequally yoked together. It makes marriage that much harder. It puts complications
also,
in there.
Also, if you feel a call on your life, make sure you're honest with your mate and tell them about that call on your life. And I think that's very important. And I won't go into it, but I just read an article just recently from doctors that have now concluded that premarital sex has something to do with enzyme that mess up your brain. That's from doctors. And so the Bible is really clear on those kinds of things.
You're throwing a lot of ad-libbing in there, you know. But the institution of marriage is not the problem. When problems show up, we often say, our marriage is the pits. Our marriage is in trouble. You know what? It's not the marriage that's in trouble. It's the trouble that's in the people that make the marriage, that make the covenant.
And I need the slide that shows old people.
Can you read what that says? That's one of our favorite sayings. When asked how they managed to stay together for 65 years, the woman replied, "We were born in a time where if something was broke, you fixed it, not throw it away." And I will tell you that Pastor and I have not had a marriage that just was without problems, without conflicts. We're both firstborns. We're both very strong-natured. I tend to be an introvert. He tends to be an extrovert. And he will tell you that he pretty well dominated me until all of a sudden he began to see my gifts. Then he began to push me. I think I was more comfortable with the domination than I was him pushing me out to be who God wanted me to be. But because of that, because of him pushing me out and releasing my gifts, it's kind of freed me from things that kept me as a prisoner within our marriage. It's made our relationship sweeter.
You know, the guardrails keep you from having regrets. I'm really serious about this. The number one regret I have of our 54 years of marriage was too much of it was about me. Too much of it was about me. My calling, when we'd go on vacation where I wanted to go, when we went out to eat where I chose to go. And so I've determined probably the last 15 years. And if you see us sitting in the car outside, we're arguing. Because I am saying, honey, God's convicted me. Now you say where we're going to go eat.
Okay, this leads me into my next point. When there is trouble in the relationship, it is due to two huge little words, I and me. When we get to the point where it's all about how I feel, what I want, what I think, what about me? I don't like this. I. When you hear yourself predominantly expressing in your thoughts, not just verbally, but in your thoughts, these type of expressions, you have a problem. Self has come in and it's muddying up the waters. Marriage is about two people who've come from totally different backgrounds coming together to create a brand new family. And you will bring baggage from your side, your mate will bring baggage from their side, and somehow you've got to learn how to get all that baggage to fit together. And that's a big thing that you have to work on. marriage is about, and some of us don't understand this when we get married. We look at marriage through rosy-tinted glasses. But marriage is a commitment of a man that says, I am going to serve and love my wife over myself. And marriage for a woman is choosing to serve and honor her husband over herself. Did you know nowhere in the Bible does it tell a wife to love her husband? But it tells us over and over we're to honor them. See, this comes from a generation back then where the parents picked the mate, usually, or the mate
was... That's a very good idea.
Or the mate was chosen while she was very young. And in doing that, quite often it took a while for a love relationship, if ever, to develop. I think of the story of Leah and Rachel. Do you remember that? How he loved the one and hated the other? But because she continued to love during all that time, I preach a sermon on this, the ugly and unloved. At the end of his life, he was able to say, Jacob was able to say, Leah, you have become beautiful in my eyes. And he asked to be buried with her, not with Rachel. Love won over because selfishness was not the motive. The other thing that is a guardrail, marriage without putting the spiritual emphasis on it is never as sweet. Yes, there are successful marriages out in the world that are not based on a spiritual foundation. But to make it the sweetest that God intended it to be, the marriages that are the strongest and the healthier ones are ones that are based on a spiritual agreement and growth together. God in your marriage, God in your sex life, God in your relationship, God in your children, those emphases in your marriage, which we so often forget to include. We come and we're spiritual on Sunday, but we don't quite take it home to all of these little crevices and areas in our life that God wants to be a big part of. Now, there is a anachrom that I want to give you today, and it's called the, T-H-E, and it's taken from Proverbs 4, 23, 24, and 25. Now, I have taken 24 and put it as first, and then 23 and 25, because it fits. I want you to remember the. When you walk out of here, the guardrails I'm talking to you about are concrete guardrails that stand up on their own, that are easily defined, and they're from God's word. And I want you to remember, I'm going to talk to you about the tongue, the heart, and guess what the other one is? The eyes. Those are three areas God said you better put your guardrails up or you're in trouble. And I take that from Proverbs, and I want to deal with the tongue first of all. Proverbs 4:24 says, and I'm using the New Living, or the NIV? Yeah, that's what I'm using. Okay.
FC4.
And it's stated this way in that version. Put away perversity from your mouth. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Now, when I first heard that, instantly when I read that, the vision of perversion or perversity brought up perversion. You know, I was thinking something totally different than what's meant by the scripture. And when I saw corrupt, I thought dirty jokes and filthy talk and that kind of stuff. That is not what it meant. I began to tear this verse apart this week, getting ready for this service. And listen to this. In a marriage relationship, because in this whole chapter, or in this whole section, if you get down to 26 and 27, it's talking about how you're to make your way straight so that when you walk, you won't fall. And it's those three things above that's going to make your way straight to keep you from falling. And with the tongue, this perversity means with one another, you don't use crooked talk, warped, reckless talk, anything that will hurt or injure the other. That's what perversity is in your marriage. When you say things that are not quite true, they're kind of shaded, they're reckless, they're hurtful, they're painful, you are using perversity, and God said, set up a guardrail on your tongue. Guard your tongue that you do not do that. And when it goes to the corrupt is anything that will destroy, that will break your spirit, that will bring ruins to something that's good, that will defile, stain, or pollute. That's pretty heavy this morning. When we think about in our marriage how we talk to each other, what we say to each other, we are not to stain, we're not to pollute, we're not to hurt, we're not to be shady with what we say or reckless with what we say. We, the scripture says, are commanded to put guards before our tongue that this does not happen in the marriage situation. Now, those of you who are not married, guess what? These principles apply to every relationship you have with your children, with your friends, with your boss at work, everywhere you go. So don't sit here and say, I shouldn't even have come today. This isn't even about me. No, you don't get off that easy. It's good for all of us. But today, I am sick and tired of Christian marriages falling apart and not glorifying God, being unhealthy, being a struggle from the day that, the moment they get up in the morning to the moment they go to bed at night. What does it say to the world about us? And I'm on the warpath against what the enemy is trying to do to marriages. So number one guardrail is put a guard before your tongue. Do not be perverse and corrupt in your communications with your mate in that area.
And you know, hon, I often tell young couples in premarital counseling, keep your words sweet, because when you have to eat them, they taste better.
Oh, yes. And you know, there's an old adage that says, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. I got news for you. There are people that will stay in abusive situations physically where they won't put up with verbal abuse. Verbal abuse can be more destructive because it not only hurts you psychologically, it does your self-image, it does your self-consciousness, it does your pride in yourself. It breaks down everything in you. And words, where a stone may hit and bruise you, it may break you, that will heal. Guess what? Words get stored in what's called the wellspring of your heart. And they get stored up. And they will come out. It will bite you in the end.
And one way you can start changing your vocabulary, I try never to miss a day that I do not say, Carol, I love you. Next to Jesus, you're the greatest thing that ever happened to me. Now, that's not because I'm trying to get her, you know, excited about me. That's a fact. She is.
That's a fact, Jack. Well, and there's another side to that, too. There are sometimes, now get this one. Girls, here's a good one. There are sometimes I know I love him with all my heart, but at the moment, I don't like him at all. Anybody know? Have you ever had your kids? You love your kids. You love them, but at the moment, you don't like them. You'd like to adopt them out. Well, you know what? That happens in marriage sometimes. Not only
adopt me out?
No, but there have been times when I've said, you know, I love you, but right now I just don't like you. So one of the greatest compliments to him, because he knows I love him, one of the greatest compliments to him is in the morning when I say, I like you today. I like you today. Honey, I like you today. Okay? The second... The second guardrail that Proverbs talks about is that verse 23... And it says, above all else, this is the most important one. This is according to God's word spoken to us in the book of Proverbs. Above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. And I want to put Luke 6:45 with this. Because in the New Testament, it says, a good man will bring good things out of the good that he has stored up in his heart. An evil man will bring out evil out of the evil stored up in his heart. For out of the overflow of his heart, the mouth speaketh. Now, we were just talking about watch what your tongue says, because it's going to cause things to be stored up in someone else's heart. Well, those things that are getting stored up, if they are not good things, are going to come back to bite you. And those who are having hurtful things said against them, I want to tell you something right now. Nobody, not your mate, nobody but God, should be able to control your happiness with life. You are in charge of your happiness. You are in charge of deciding how you're going to respond, how you're going to act. And all of us say with our mouth, if I have Jesus, I don't need anything else until something goes wrong in the marriage or some financial disaster. And then we find out, oh, I need all that other to be happy. Jesus wants us to know we need nothing but him. And a lot of marriages would survive if the mate refused to store up the perversity and corruption that may be thrown at them. Are you hearing me this morning? That is your choice if you're going to store it, if you're going to think on it, if you're going to allow it to build up. You in your relationship, in marriage, at work, with children, you either say, I'm going to put up a guard that refuses to store up this evil, or let me tell you what, at some point it's going to roll right out of there and you're going to be eating words that you wish you didn't have to eat.
Honey, is that the same as, and I know it's a lot harder for you than it is for me because you can remember things that I forget, but does that mean, I mean like 54 years ago, I'm really sorry I didn't vacuum the church on our wedding day. But I felt the car needed to be washed. We're getting down to the real stuff now, baby. So you didn't build that up in your heart. You just remembered it.
You know what? Do you know?
Look at her.
Oh, I've got it here. He can't get ahead of me. How many know what 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 1 through 8 says? It's God's love, and we're to imitate God's love. We're to make it part of our life, and you're to never keep a record of wrongs. You're never to, you know, all the good things.
Preach it, babe.
And keep believing. Well, you know what? I found out I'm not God. And I found out that I'm going to be working on that till the day he takes me home. So some of these areas I know. Do you know what? I'm learning. We're counseling with Renan and his girlfriend for marriage counseling, and I'm finding out all kinds of things that I had to learn the hard way. And I was telling my husband, I wished I'd had this book before I married you. Things would have been a lot different. I wouldn't have stored up some things, and I would have been more open with how I felt. I would have told you, back off, buddy. No, I'm teasing. Anyway, back to this heart issue.
Glad we didn't have books in those days.
Oh, honey, it could have been so much sweeter so much sooner. It takes a conscious effort, though, to store up good things. There's a passage in Philippians 4 that talks about you're to think on good things. And I'll touch on that a little bit more. Well, no, I'm going to go ahead. Philippians 4:8, it says, whatever is true, if something's said and you know it's not true about you, then refuse to store it in your heart. Just understand he's under pressure. She's not feeling good. You know, so many times the things that come out of our mouth have nothing to do with the person we're throwing them at. It has to do with an intent or an inside thing that's eating at us, a pressure. And if the person that feels like they're being shot at would understand or take time to back up and say, why is he saying that? Maybe even respond in a different manner instead of saying, I don't deserve that. Just say, okay, let's talk about this. What did I do? How could I do it differently? Communication's the number one tool. And in your marriage, your heart must be guarded. You must consciously choose not to store up evil, but to store up good in your heart. Because it's not going to fill itself up automatically with good, but it will. Evil is like a weed. How many notice you got a baby plants and veggies, flowers? You got to baby them to get them to grow. But them cotton picking weeds don't need any help. They hardly even need water. That's the way it is with evil. It wants to store up in your heart. It's one way the enemy has of ruining the testimony of a healthy marriage and our relationship with Jesus Christ. So we're to think on the good things, the excellent and praiseworthy aspects of our relationship, and it will change what will come out of the well of your heart. This is a very important guardrail. If we tend to dwell on the mistakes and the weaknesses that are in our marriage, our thoughts, and this is, I think it's on the overhead for you. You want to fill these blanks in. Our thoughts will determine our words And ultimately, our words will determine our actions. Now, you need to remember that. Let me say that again. Your thoughts, my thoughts, will determine the words that come out of my mouth, and those words will end up bringing forth action. This is why we need to guard our heart. Breaking trust, creating security, and destroying commitment is what the negative issues are that come from wellsprings, and we don't want them there. The last concrete point that I want to talk about is found in Proverbs 4:25 about your eyes. Proverbs 4:25 says, "Let your eyes look straight ahead and fix your gaze directly before you." In marriage, both partners need to concentrate on their own responsibilities. Did you get that? Their own responsibilities for creating a secure marriage, and they cannot be distracted by temptations and potential things that would destroy their marriage. You have to get your eyes focused on, I want this relationship to be the best thing that's ever happened to him or from him to her. Your commitment to God, what love really is an intentional reasoning force to make that person you marry the best person he can possibly be by being his side mate.
Or she.
Or she, yes. And so you have to keep your eyes focused on that fact, and anything that would detract you, anything that would cause your partner to lose trust in you, keep your eyes off of those things. It can be hobbies. It can be something as innocent as having a hobby that takes so much of your time that your mate feels second place. It can be work. It can be goals that you have set that you are so bound and determined that you're going to reach those goals that your mate becomes second. At least they feel they're second. In your heart, they may not be. But your eyes have to be guardrailed to see what is healthy for your marriage and what is not. This is a determination you need the Holy Spirit to help you make. You cannot always do this on your own. And the Holy Spirit will come in and put a guard before your eyes. There's another scripture in Psalms, and I don't have it in my notes, but I'm thinking of it now, where David says, "Lord, I want you to come to my house. And I have determined that I will not set in my house, I will not set anything before my eyes that is vile." We, as the marriage partners, the foundation of the home, are responsible for what the vision is in our home. What is being looked at, what is being put into the wellsprings of the hearts that are there, whether it's our mate or whether it is our children. For my husband now is going to talk about
my four turn. Fluid.
Yes, it's your turn. Yay. I'm going to interrupt you like you did me, though, okay? He's talking about fluid guardrails, because the concrete ones, I mean, everybody knows what you find your eyes and your heart represent. But when we start talking about commitment and finances and that kind of stuff, those are kind of fluid. They can kind of spread out and touch a lot of things. So, honey, go for it.
Okay. And we'll go really, really pretty fast. I want to talk about commitment. And this is what commitment means to me. It means the spouse never again has to compete for your affection or your attention. Let me say it again. When you get married, your commitment should include that your spouse will never again have to compete for your affection or your attention.
In other words, you're leaving the courting thing. In the courting thing, you're constantly competing for that one, that person's attention is focused to be on you. And somehow when we get married, all of a sudden, we just think, we've caught that guy, we caught that gal, we don't have to work at it anymore.
The second thing is, under commitment, when you get married, singleness is over. Write that down. Because a lot of times young couples don't pick up on that. You're so used. That's why if you're going to be late because you stopped to play basketball with the boys, better call home. See? And so there's a lot of things that you have to do with singleness. And a lot of people are getting married older. Now, when we were in our day, if a girl wasn't engaged by the time she's a senior in high school, she could be an old maid. Because there wasn't college student loans or anything like that. So Carol was 3 days from being 18, and I was 22 when we got married. We'd have got married when she was 16, but her mother had some kind of crazy idea, and her family thought I was terrible. And
whatever would have made them think that?
Your family was mixed up. They couldn't see a jewel right in front of them. So singleness is over. You know, divorce has never been a word in our marriage vocabulary. Because it creates insecurity and everything else. Now, murder has been.
I'm going to kill him, God, and tell you he just died, and I can get witnesses.
But we never talked about divorce. I remember one day, Terry is a sophomore in high school. He's a deputy chief of police of Watsonville, and he's always been a big boy. He comes home, doesn't say anything. He grabs me by the collar, and he starts shaking me. And I'm thinking, boy, this better be good, because when you stop, I'm starting. And I'm going to give you a whooping, boy. And he was saying, don't ever do this. Don't ever do this. And I thought, what in the world? You know, what's wrong? And a kid that he grew up with and his baseball coach and everything, his son just come and said, Terry, my mom and dad are getting a divorce. And Terry was just shaking me. Promise me you'll never divorce mom. Well, that wasn't hard to promise. But those kind of things... Now, see, I know that because I come from a divorced family. My parents were divorced when I was 5. My biological father had nothing to do with me, and I carry the name of my stepfather. My mother was remarried at when I was 10, and this is how I found out. My grandpa called me in, and he said, Buster, don't you ever repeat that to anybody. That's my nickname. Buster. Do you know the guy, because my grandfather owned a lot of logging trucks, you know the guy that drives number 10? I said, yes. Yeah, I think I know him. He said, he's your new father. That's how I found out. See?
But, and you know what Pastor's saying is, your commitment in a healthy marriage is a foundation that your home is going to be built on. If you don't have strong commitment that your children can witness and see. If you're throwing around stupid words like divorce, I hate you, I don't like you, wish I never married you, you throw that kind of thing around, you're going to have very insecure family issues. And commitment is not just for you. Yes, it is for a solid marriage. It's to glorify God, but it has ramifications. That's why we call it fluid. Those ramifications just flow out in so many directions.
Here's something, just a side note, doesn't cost you anything. This is a myth. I'll change them after we're married. That's a myth. Right? Well, moving right along.
I didn't say amen.
Amen. You need to discover in your commitment to each other, discover conflict mechanisms. Because you're going to have conflict. In fact, this sermon almost cost me sleeping on the couch. Didn't it?
Do you really want to go there?
No, not really. We'll just kind of skip that along. We were not on the same page. When upset, we have two different kinds of approach. She wants to be quiet and process it. Well, that drives me nuts. I want to talk it out and fix it. How many know men, we're about fixing things? See? And so I will press her, and she'll say, no, no. And I'll say, yes, yes, wrong. I don't know why I do that. It never ends up in my favor. When she finally, okay, you want to know? And I thought it was just one thing. And man, we go back 30 years. I mean, it's like catalog. Just bam, 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 bam.
Okay, we're talking about commitment and guardrails to commitment. One of our guardrails, honey, that you haven't shared yet is when we get into a thing like that to protect each other so that we are not putting negative into the wellsprings of the other's heart. We back off while the issue's still hot. Am I correct? Yeah. Dan Percorny saw this happen a couple times when he was remodeling our house. And we go out.
And you got upset. Meaningless. It was meaningless.
We're not going there. We go out to a restaurant where we know almost everybody in Modesto knows us. It puts peer pressure on us to be careful what words come out of our mouth because it's not going to just hit each other. It's going to be spread all over town. And so we go somewhere that sets up a guardrail for our mouth so that our commitment will not be damaged between the two of us. Our commitment to the Lord is not damaged. Again, that commitment is so fluid. It touches so many things in your life. It has to be protected.
And it really helped when coffee was only 15 cents a cup because you just kept getting refills, refills. And more refills. Another thing, do you know most communication, the problem is misunderstanding? And so we do what we call mirror. I'll say something, and then I'll say, tell me what I just said. And she'll repeat it back to me, and I'll say, yes, that's what I said, but that's not what I meant.
Voice inflection is so... so tantamount when you start saying something. He can say to me, you should not have done that. Or he can say, you shouldn't have done that. Now, which one of those am I going to respond to? Huh? Yeah?
The latter one, I get whooped.
You better get going to trust.
So, okay. and both of, understand that you're created differently psychologically as well as physically. And Carol and my daughter's the same way. They got to have space. Any women have to have space. You just need space. I don't understand that at all. I want people around me. I go through the house and the TVs I turn on. Every light's on. Radios are on. I got to have. And instead, she wants to leave me. I just don't understand. You got the best thing going for you, girl, and you want to leave? So every now and then, I do. In fact, she just a couple weeks ago, and I let her go off by herself, and she gets on a zip line. That's why I can't let her just go off. Oh, I'm still on. Trust. I want to talk about trust because the gold isn't the best sex life or the most possessions. It's becoming best friends. You want to put that slide up? Becoming best friends. Carol is my best friend. I trust her explicitly. I sometimes have not listened to her, and that's cost us. Because she tried to put up red flags, but I didn't pay attention to them. And so try to become best friends, okay? As well as best lovers and as well as possessing things, become best friends. I read this article of a couple that had been married 72 years. Just read it this week. And they put them right side by side because they love to hold hands. That's gone out of style. But they were holding hands, and the husband died. But the son kept looking and said, "Well, my dad's not breathing, but the heart monitor is showing a heartbeat. And the nurse said, oh, that's because your mom and dad are holding hands and it's her heartbeat that's coming through. And so he said, well, let mom and dad just hold hands a little bit longer. And then in about 30 minutes or so, she died too. Now that's becoming best friends. That's becoming best friends.
Do you know you can have commitment in a marriage and not be best friends? And being best friends, having that trust, which is built not overnight. You're not going to have trust the day you walk out of the church from your wedding. Trust has to be built, and it has to be protected. When a small plant is coming out, it's so vulnerable. The least little pressure can break it, crush it, and the fruit will never come forth. Trust has to be built one day at a time as you become best friends.
One other thing, I'd just like to have you put up a guardrail. In our day, when we first got married, very few women worked. Now today, almost every woman has to work to make it. Put a guardrail up against what is called workplace romance.
It'll break the trust.
Be careful how you talk to people of the opposite sex. Now, I will tell you, Carol and I cut up a lot, as you can see, but there's some things that are off limits. Our private life is our private life. And we don't talk about that to anybody else. And I think that's important because you can get, you know what I'm talking about. Put up a guardrail about that. Secondly, put up a guardrail. Never alone with the opposite sex, not your spouse. I've always had that personal guardrail. In fact, as everybody, and I see some of Blaine and his lovely wife and some that have worked for me, no woman has ever been worked at Bethel Church on Bethel campus that Carol didn't approve. They have a built-in something that we don't have, men. Wives have it.
Well, men can't afford to have it. If men were sensitive with women, they would be attacked in the workplace constantly and not be able to hold it together. They're the shell that protects the family. The woman is the cord that twangs with every sensitive thing that comes in the home. She senses things. It's just the way God made it. And when you learn to work those things together, you build trust so strong. You cement it so strong. If you don't disregard one another and resent one another, when moments like that come where I'm trusting him for protection, but he needs to listen to what I'm sensing.
See, it's very important in the trust level. I do not want Carol ever, ever to worry about me. One time I fly a lot, and over the I think I was in Boston or something or some city in this nice hotel, and I don't understand. She must have been hard up or whatever. But this gal hit on me. This is quite a few years ago, and when I got in a hot tub, she got in a hot tub. Only I had more clothes on than she did. And then when I went to my room, she followed me up and she said, we'll only need one bed. And I'm freaking out, you know. But nothing happened. And so when I got home, I didn't tell Carol anything. And she said, what's the matter? Right? What's the matter? Nothing's the matter.
I said, you're acting awfully guilty or like you're trying to hide something.
Isn't that the pitch? You don't do anything and you feel guilty?
But that's the trust level. Yeah, it is.
And could I say one more thing about trust is, the social media. Boy, put guardrails up, yes. Young people. Stuff that... that's shared on that, it bothers me. Porno, I can't believe the statistics about how many men, Christian men, watch pornography. I can't believe the statistics of how many Christian women watch pornography and all of that stuff. Listen, that's so unfair to your mate. They're never going to live up to that. Probably never going to. And it puts such undue pressure. But watch the Twitter. Watch the chat rooms. And
you know what? I'm going
to. No, don't watch it. But I mean, put up guardrails. You know what I mean.
I'm going to take it a step farther. As a pastor's wife, I went on Facebooks. One of the main reasons, because I wanted to see where and what was going on with a lot of the young married couples in my church. I'm going to put a caution out right here. You guys need to be careful, all of you, about what you are saying on Facebook, that the whole world, they have schools now that are trying to show the kids, train the kids how one little segment put on here can go viral around the world. And you are sharing anger, frustration, hatred, stuff that you should take nowhere but to the Lord or meet with a person individually. And that in itself will break down not maybe the trust in your marriage, but it's going to break down trust in your relationship with the family of God and those that you are in relationship. Be careful what you're putting on there.
I've got to hurry. This is really personally extremely satisfying to me. Is your pastor is squirming because I've taken so much time.
Stop it. Stop. Hurry.
Well, look how many times. Okay, okay. Emotion. Let me just say this, folks. Guardrail about expectation versus performance. Because you may not know this, but you're married to another human being.
And sometimes you think you know that person so well, that's why you're going to marry him. You're so much alike. You know each other inside and out. This is going to be a good marriage. You are going to be so shocked.
See.
After the vows, after the wedding's all been cleaned up and put away and the meal and the dancing and all that's gone, you find out you're two different people than you thought you were.
See, it's not a lot of times in your marriage, it's not a matter of who's right or who's wrong. It's the perspective. I had a couple come in, and he said, she's the worst housekeeper in the world. And she said, I am not. Well, being brilliant as I am, I discerned there's a problem here. And so I said, tell me what you think is a good housekeeper. Well, first thing, he said, my mother. Oh, God. This is not going to work. Just go get a divorce. No, I didn't say that. But I said, well, what did your mother think? Well, my mother thought that the kitchen was where you prepared food, and it had to be spotless. The rest of the house could be cluttered, but the kitchen. Well, but the wife said, well, my mother thought the kitchen is where you're working all the time. It could be cluttered, and the rest of the house. They were both right. There was nobody wrong. But it was expectation versus performance. And a lot of conflict arrives in those areas. And so I think it's important. And secondly, it's sad to report, but some things are never going to be agreed on in your marriage. There's some things, just get over it. So get on.
Get on. Get you're, on. You're That's not, a good word. Get on. Come on.
What we expect and the actual performance of our partner may be miles. I read this other story, and I'm done with one more thing. I read this story where this guy comes to his wife and he says, I want a divorce. Sign the papers. She said, okay, I will if you'll do one thing. And he said, what's that? She said, you hug me every day for 30 days. At the end of 30 days, he didn't want a divorce. He had forgot the hug. There's something very, very significant in that. I love you and hug. And then financial. I want to just, that's fluid. How many know finances are fluid? In today, out tomorrow. Okay? Be equal in your decision making. Now, I personally keep all of the... She never sees a bill. She never... But I'm an administrator. That's my gifting, so I do it. If you're not good at that and your wife is, so I never say this is a husband's role or the wife's role. But whoever keeps the books, they'd better keep it right. Because there's three things that I find bring people to divorce. Number one is conversation. They don't know how to communicate. Secondly, sexual incompatibility, and thirdly, finances. I've counseled hundreds of couples, and it can fall in those three areas. I've seen couples with bad finances and bad sexual incompatibility, but good communication and make it. So I put communication as number one. So work on that. Avoid early debt temptation. You know, you get married and you move out and you want to have everything that it took 40 years for mom and dad to have. And because of credit, you can get it. But everything you borrow, in case you don't know it, you have to pay it back with interest.
And that brings tension in a marriage that is almost hard to get over.
Do you know what our first monthly grocery bill was allowed in our budget? $20.
A month. Yeah.
You say, boy, they are antique, aren't they? No, but you have that. A budget? I think you need to do a budget. I always use the 10-80-10. 10% belongs to God. Always did. And then 80% I live on, and 10% I put in savings, because when you're young, you're driving along and you have a tire and it puts you upside down, a tire blowout, just little things. So you start doing that, and if you get extra money, don't be tempted just to spend it because you got extra money. I hope all of that helps.
Okay, in closing, we want to tell you again, reiterate, you need to put guards about your tongue, your heart, and your eyes. You need to put some guards about your trust issues, your commitment, your emotions, and your finances. And in closing this out today, I don't think there's a more fitting closing than a principle that God's been working out in my life the last 2 months. And, you know, we've been married, as I said, 54 years, but you don't ever reach the perfection mark. You're always growing. As long as you are breathing, there are things that you can work out in your marriage. That's such a picture of your relationship with Jesus Christ. And about 2 months ago or so, some of you have heard me talk about this, but God made a message to me, and it was found in Ezekiel in the Message Bible. And I was just having my devotions, and I don't usually study out of that, but this hit me so hard, and it's changed my life. And I'm not going to give you the scripture itself. You can look it up, but you need to read it in the Message to get this context. It's chapter 20, verses 7 through 44. Four times in that passage, God shows that he understands our struggles with emotions and relationships. God himself chose to make a covenant of marriage with the Israelites. Jesus has made a covenant with the new church, the New Testament believers. We are the bride of Christ. How many have heard that? Well, guess what? God himself had problems in his relationship and marriage. He got so angry, he was threatening to kill him. Do you remember in the desert when he said, I'm going to wipe them all out? And Moses said, well, if you do that, what are people going to think of you? You took us out here to worship you and you kill us all. And here is how God dealt with his own marriage conflicts and his disappointments at rebellion, idolatry, lack of love, just all the things that we as humans do to one another. He said to Ezekiel four times, he reminded him, here's what I told myself. I will not act by how I feel, but by who I am. There is no better guardrail to guardrail all of these things than to put that statement of God himself into motion in your life. I am not going to act by how I feel, but by who I am. Would you stand with me? I want to read Proverbs one more time to you. Above all else, guard your heart, for it's a wellspring of life. Put away perversity from your mouth. Keep corrupt talk from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Make level paths for your feet. See, all those guardrails are making it where you don't go off the edge. It's making a straight road. Take only the ways that are firm and do not swerve to the right or the left. Keep your foot from evil. Lord Jesus, I ask that you would speak to each one of our hearts. Lord, there was something in here for every single one of us, whether we've been married 60 years, 6 months, or we're just thinking about marriage, or we've decided to be single. Lord, there are principles here that will change our life. This morning, touch your people's hearts. Lord Jesus, may they go out of here committed, Lord, to putting those guardrails up that will cause their life to shine for you, that our Father in heaven may be glorified by our good works. This morning, I just want you in your own heart just to begin to say, God, what in this area, what guardrails here are you wanting me to put up? I'm going to ask you just to close your eyes, and I want the worship team to come, and they're going to sing a song. I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to say anything. I want the Holy Spirit to talk to you. I want you to just bow your head, and I want you to have a conversation with the Holy Spirit who dwells inside of you if you're a believer. I want the Holy Spirit to tell you what you're to be working on, what guardrails you need to start putting up, what ones you need to repair, what of these touched your heart that you need to work on. And this morning, I'm going to pray over you as you are letting the Holy Spirit speak to you. I'm going to pray that it goes beyond just a sermon that you walk out of here and say, oh, that was fun. They were funny. That touched some areas I could identify with. No, we're going to go beyond identifying today. We're going to go to applying in our life the Word of God. We're going to be stronger. We're going to be a better witness. We're going to be a better testimony for Jesus Christ. Would you go ahead and just begin to sing this morning? Lord, as your people have their heads bowed, as they're looking in their own heart this morning at areas the devil would try and tempt them and break them up, if the wellsprings of the heart are full of negative, Lord, if things are weaknesses and failures are being the thing that we're focusing on, Lord, change us today. Help us to put up the guardrails that will protect us in these areas that are so vital, Lord, to a healthy marriage and a healthy life in Christ. I thank you for your word. It's a light unto our path, Lord. Shine your light. Shine your light into our hearts, I pray. In Jesus' name, Pastor Tracy, will you please take us?
Hallelujah. Amazing word. Wisdom, experience, anointing. So let's just sing a couple choruses before we close today. What a privilege, what a privilege, what a privilege to have an anointed couple of God speaking into our lives. I'm checked today. I'm checked in my spirit. Lord, would you just minister to us this morning, Lord? Do a deep work, Lord God, in our hearts, in our spirits, in our minds today, God. Do a deep work, Lord. Help us, God, to reflect in all of our relationships, in our homes, in our marriages, with our friends, God. Help us reflect you, God. Help us to love our wives and honor our husbands, Lord, that bring you glory, that we would be a blessing, God. I want to be a blessing on my husband, Lord. I want to bless him, God. What a privilege, Lord, when you call us into marriage according to your design, your perfect design, Lord. Let us not be reckless, God, with our relationships that you have given us, Lord. Let us not be reckless. Let us be thoughtful and humble, serving you and serving each other, Lord. If you'll just sing for a few moments. And just let the Lord just minister to you, strengthen you, reveal places in your heart. Thank you, Jesus.
You are welcome.
Yes, you are.
You are welcome.
Yes, Lord.
You are welcome.
You're welcome in our hearts, Lord.
You are welcome.
In our minds, God.
You are welcome.
Come into our marriages, Lord.
Holy.
If you have places in your marriages that you've guarded up, that you've protected, maybe you've been hurt, would you lay those down just in your heart before the Lord today? So let Him do a work.
We want to know.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, Spirit of God, come like the dawn. Open the heavens on us. We want to know you. We want to know you. Come, I believe.
My marriage to reflect, God, your marvelous love. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Pastor Tracy and I, we love you. Pray that your hearts are stirred and your spirit is stirred, and that you would take this with you today and let this word just settle in you and use it, right? Apply it to your lives. Next week is work day. Please sign up. And so, man, we need you out here helping to clear off and do our next project here at Crossroads. Also, dinner tonight at 5:30 for those of you who are going to be joining us. And men, would you please help us stack chairs before you leave? 8 high against the wall, because we're going to be setting up for that dinner. We love you. Be blessed in Jesus' name.